Okay, so without further ado, I'll turn it over to our next group who is talking on asymptotics of Bernoulli-Gibbsian line ensembles.
Thank you for the introduction. Our group consists of Sean, Lucas, Christian, Carson, and myself. And we have a grad student advisor, Wei Tao, and special thanks to our advisor, Evgeny Dimitrov. And today we're going to talk about the asymptotics of Bernoulli-Gibbsian line ensembles. So first, let's talk about a universality class. A universality class identifies the behavior of systems as they approach a limit. So here are some well-known results for the Gaussian universality class. So suppose Xi's are a sequence of independently identically distributed random variables with a mean and a variance, and let Sn be the sum of these variables. The law of large numbers says that Sn over n will converge almost surely to the mean. And central limit theorem says that if you rescale Sn by the mean and the variance, they will converge in distribution to the standard Gaussian distribution. And lastly, the Donsker theorem says that if you define this new function like random variable WNT with like rescaled SN and interpolating to them into a function, then WN will also converge in distribution to a standard Brownian motion as it's shown in the picture. And as the steps are smaller, the random walk will become a Brownian motion. So suppose of instead of one random walk, which is one SN, we have more random walks, and we can construct a line ensemble from these like several random walks. So if the Xi's we were talking about are Bernoulli random variables, then the sequence SN will become a Bernoulli random walk. And if we put k Bernoulli random walks together with every curve on top of each other, with L1 here, L2 on the bottom, and so on until LK, with random initial and ending conditions on the interval T0 to T1, then the ensemble will be called an avoiding Bernoulli line ensemble, and it's a special case of the Bernoulli-Gibbsian line ensemble. So the question becomes, if there is a limit when we have infinite number of curves. And as is shown in the picture, if we increase the number of curves to infinity, then the avoiding random walks will be conjectured to look like the Airy line ensemble on the edge, with the top curve converging to the Airy process A1. Actually increasing the number of walks will push us outside of the Gaussian universality class and into the KPZ universality class. And it remains the open problem that any kind of random walk with generic initial and ending conditions will always converge to the Airy line ensemble. And the problem is actually only known for the special condition that if you use Bernoulli random walks and if every line every walk starts from zero. So actually it's interesting to see that for like the KPZ universality class, you get something that looks like an Airy line ensemble on the edge. And but if you compare it to the Gaussian universality class, everything it's very classical. The behavior is known for any IID random variables, and you always get like a Gaussian random variable, or like if you're talking about the function, the Brownian motion in the end. Versus when we're talking about KPZ, we don't have a formal distribution description for the line ensemble, and we almost always have to specify the start and end, and the limit is in the end is not Gaussian, so the problem becomes harder. And now I'll pass on to Carson to talk about our setup for the problem.
Person. Camp Angela left. We will have this line ensembles for the next slide. Sorry. Random initial and end. and find
Maybe I should take over. Is he losing connection?
Yeah, unfortunately, I think so. So those who didn't notice before, Carson is being very quite the adventuresome presenter today. He's trying to do it from his car with limited power, and unfortunately, it's not seeming to work. So Christian, if you want to take over, that'd be great.
Okay. Sure. So to prove this convergence to the Airy line ensemble, it turns out that we have two kind of sufficient conditions that will allow us to prove this convergence. The first is called finite dimensional convergence. And this is generally a bit difficult to prove. It requires a lot of kind of exact algebraic formulas. The other is called tightness, and this is roughly the existence of weak subsequential limits. This is usually an easier problem. It's a bit more analytic, and this is what we focused on. So it turns out that tightness can be proven by controlling three quantities: the maximum of our sequence, the minimum, and the modulus of continuity. And this can be, by analogy, there's a classical result from analysis that if you have a bounded sequence or sequence in a compact set, then it has a convergent subsequence. So that's kind of a rough analogy to how these conditions are sufficient for tightness. And this picture here shows what this modulus of continuity is. It's roughly a measure of how continuous our function is. So if we can go to the next slide, please. So we were able to prove the following result, which gives us a condition for tightness of our sequence. So we have a sequence Ln of k avoiding Bernoulli random walks. We fix a parameter p in 0 to 1 and lambda greater than 0. And our assumption is that for all integer times little n, we have this kind of convergence result. So if we look at the top curve with this affine shift and this parabolic shift, and that's kind of shown in the figure here, the 1-point marginals of this random variable converge to some limit called the Tracy-Widom distribution. And that is just the 1-point marginal for the Airy process, which is conjectured to be the limit of the top curve. So if we assume this result, which is actually a fairly mild assumption, then we conclude that the sequence formed by just the top k minus 1 curves of our sequence is a tight sequence. So this is a kind of a strengthening of a recent result due to Dovern, Nika, and Virag. So they proved that if we assume finite dimensional convergence for all curves, then we get this tightness. But we're only assuming something about the top curve, and it's even weaker than finite dimensional convergence. We're just kind of assuming that it converges, these 1-point marginals converge. So this is actually a significant strengthening of that result. And this figure kind of shows what that parabolic shift is. So the top curve is meant to look kind of parabolic in shape on large scales. So if we can go to the next slide, please, thanks. So the arguments that we come up with are inspired mainly by recent papers by two authors, or two pairs of authors, rather. So the first are two papers due to Ivan Corwin and Alan Hammond on the Brownian Gibbs property for Airy line ensembles and the KPZ line ensemble. These papers talk about similar issues for continuous line ensembles with Brownian motion. And then secondly, we have a paper due to Ivan Corwin and Evgeny Dimitrov about transversal fluctuation of the ASEP, and this treats similar issues in a discrete setting. So for the remainder of the talk, I'd like to discuss some of the ideas and methods that we use to prove our tightness statement. So remember, there are three quantities that we can control in order to prove tightness. Firstly, we have the minimum. Now, since our curves are ordered, this corresponds to just controlling the minimum of our bottom curve, indexed k minus 1. Secondly, we have the maximum for the top curve. And lastly, this modulus of continuity. Today, we're just going to focus on how we control the minimum. So the control we have is encoded in this lemma 1 here. We fix an r greater than 0, as well as a small epsilon. then we can find a big constant m such that for all large enough n, if we look at the minimum or the infimum on this interval from minus r to r of our bottom curve with this affine shift as before, and notice everything here is scaled by n to the 2/3 on the domain, the probability that this minimum is less than minus m times n to the 1/3 is less than epsilon. So this is saying that with high probability, our bottom curve can't dip too low on scale n to the 1/3, which is kind of the square root of the size of our horizontal domain. So the bottom curve can't dip too low on that scale. So we'll explain how we prove this lemma, but for simplicity, we're mostly going to consider the case of two curves, meaning that LK minus one will be our second curve. So there are two important tools we use to prove this result that are kind of inspired by recent papers. So if we can go to the next slide, please. So the first is called monotone coupling. And we were able to prove a lemma of this type by adapting arguments from Corwin and Hammond's paper. So often if we want to study some random walks, it's useful to first fix the entry and exit data, by which I just mean the values of the curves at the endpoints. So in principle, these are random, but if we fix them, we have some random paths between the fixed points. So suppose we start with this red pair of avoiding random walks in this figure here, with endpoints fixed at these x and y's. Now suppose we push the values at the endpoints down to these new blue values written with primes. So in principle, it's possible for the blue paths with those endpoints to come up and cross the red paths at some points because these are just random paths. But the monotone coupling lemma tells us that actually we have a probability space in which these two random variables, these two pairs of avoiding random walks are coupled. And in particular, the red paths lie uniformly above the corresponding blue paths on the whole interval with probability one. So this is a very useful result. One application is suppose we want to upper bound the probability of the bottom curve in this red line ensemble dipping below some level, as in our lemma one. Sometimes the values of the endpoints can be difficult to work with for various reasons, but we can push them down to values that are better for our analysis. And then the lemma monotone coupling tells us that this new blue curve with these endpoints is even lower stochastically, so it's more likely to fall below that level. So we get that inequality at the bottom, and then it suffices to lower to upper bound the right-hand side, which can be easier to do sometimes. So this tool is very useful for studying avoiding random walks. We have another tool for studying single Bernoulli random walks between two points. We call these Bernoulli bridges if we fix the endpoints. So this is called strong coupling. The statement is due to Dimitrov and Wu. So suppose we have a Bernoulli bridge on some interval 0 to n drawn in blue here. Then we can couple it with a Brownian bridge on the same interval whose standard deviation is on the order square root of n. And these two bridges are kind of exponentially close. As n grows, the maximum distance between the bridges only grows like log n squared, which is quite slow. So the precise bound we have is written here. If we look at the maximum distance between our bridges, the probability that this exceeds a constant times log n squared plus some x is bounded by a constant times e to the minus x. Often for x, we'll take, say, square root of n. If we want to bound the probability of the Bernoulli bridge dipping on scale square root n, but then square root n is much larger than log n squared for large n. So we can essentially ignore the log term. And the right-hand side is like e to the minus square root n, which is very small. So this tells us it essentially suffices to look at the probability of the Brownian bridge dipping on this scale square root n. And that's a lot easier to do. We have a lot of exact formulas for things like the distribution of the minimum and the maximum of a Brownian bridge, because it's essentially just a nice Gaussian process. So if we can go to the next slide, please. How do we use these two tools to prove our lemma one about controlling the minimum? So to remind you what that lemma is saying, I'll direct you to the figure on the left here. We're looking at this interval from minus little r to plus little r. And we want to say that in this picture, our second curve doesn't dip too low on scale n to the 1/3 in this picture below that red line. That's just the affine shift that we have. So the way that we prove this is we kind of find two points outside this interval on the left and right sides where the curve is not too low, and we kind of pin the curve at those points. And then we argue that it can't be too low in between either. So that statement is written in lemma 2 here. This says if we fix R and epsilon as before, then we can find a big R larger than R and a large constant M, so that for all large n, the probability that the maximum on this interval from little r to big R of our k minus first curve with the affine shift is less than minus m times n to the 1/3 is less than epsilon. So this is saying if we look at the interval from R to big R, with high probability our second curve can't dip uniformly low outside of that green parallelogram drawn there. And then we can kind of get the same statement on the other side just by symmetry. So this allows us to kind of pin our second curve at these two points. Now, how do we use this to prove lemma 1, to bound the minimum? So the first thing is we want to treat our second curve as kind of independent of the other curves, because as is, the curves have to avoid one another, right? So this can cause them to kind of push on each other in complicated ways. But we can solve this using monotone coupling. So we can actually just, this bottom curve is kind of here and we don't have any control over it, but we can just push it to minus infinity using the monotone coupling lemma, because this might cause the second curve to dip lower, but that's fine for our purpose because we just want an upper bound on the probability of dipping. And we can similarly separate from the top curve. So now for our second curve, we essentially have a free Bernoulli bridge between these two points that we fixed in the green parallelograms. So we can use strong coupling to compare it with a Brownian bridge. In this case, the standard deviation will be like n to the 1/3, because our interval is size n to the 2/3. We take the square root of that. And now if we have a Brownian bridge with standard deviation n to the 1/3, and it's high at the endpoints, then in the middle, it can't really dip low on scale n to the 1/3 either. And that's exactly what we wanted to prove about our second curve. So that's how we use these two powerful coupling results to prove our lemma 1. And lastly, let's just talk about how we prove this technical statement, lemma 2. So it turns out that parabolic shift mentioned earlier in our theorem is really the key to this. So to remind you, we assumed some convergence result about our top curve with this affine shift and a parabolic shift. And essentially, this forces our top curve to look like this blue parabola in this figure. We want to argue that on this interval from little r to big R, with high probability, our second curve can't dip uniformly low on the whole interval. So we kind of assume that it does dip very low, so we don't draw it here. Then essentially our top curve won't feel it. It will just look like a free random walk. And the parabolic shift assumption means we can pin that curve at the parabola at the two endpoints. So again, we have a free Bernoulli bridge. So we use the strong coupling result to compare it with a Brownian bridge, standard deviation n to the 1/3. Now, at any point in between, say we look at the midpoint of the interval, the Brownian bridge should be close to this green line segment connecting its endpoints on the scale of the standard deviation n to the 1/3. But our convergence assumption means the top curve should be close to the parabola at the midpoint. Well, we can actually quantify the distance between the two curves, and it turns out it's on the order of r squared times n to the 1/3, that red distance there. So that means that if we make r very large, the top curve would actually be very far from the parabola at the midpoint on scale n to the 1/3. And that kind of violates this convergence assumption. So that's something that can only occur with very small probability. And so that allows us to conclude that our second curve needs to be at least somewhat high somewhere on this interval to kind of push our top curve up into that parabolic shape. So it turns out this parabolic shift is really kind of a key assumption in our paper. It's one of the main tools that allows us to prevent our lower curves from dipping to minus infinity, because we kind of argue that they have to be at least somewhat high to push our top curve up into that convex shape there. So hopefully this has given you some idea of some of the tools and methods we use to prove our result. So that's all that we have for you today. So thank you all very much for listening. And if people have any questions, we'll be happy to take those now.
Yeah. So you said that your result was a strengthening of a previous result. Could you go back and tell us again what was that previous result? And maybe it's simpler to state than yours.
Let's go back one slide. Yes.
Yeah, so you said this was a strengthening of...
Yeah, so this previous result proves tightness, assuming that all curves in our sequence have this converge in the finite dimensional sense. And finite dimensional, that means convergence of finite dimensional distributions. That's significantly stronger than assuming just convergence at these one-point marginals. So in our theorem, we assumed this convergence for each integer time little n. That's kind of a one-point marginal. And we also only assume this about the top curve. We don't assume anything really, any convergence about the lower curves. But we still get the tightness conclusion.
Okay. Maybe you should explain that there is a finite difference between finite dimensional convergence and uniform convergence.
So we're assuming uniform convergence of the one point, or rather, I think what Evgeny is getting at is that, uniform convergence, do you mean in the sense of weak convergence? Sorry, you mean convergence in distribution to the limiting distribution?
I think there might be a source of confusion about this result of Duo, Veronica, and Farag. Like, they're assuming finite dimensional convergence and they're proving what? Tightness.
Right.
But
right.
Tightness is with respect to a different topology, so maybe you can explain that.
Well, tightness is... tightness, as we said, is one condition that allows you to get this uniform weak convergence. So that's a significantly stronger statement than just assuming finite dimensional convergence. I mean, for instance, the finite dimensional distributions are just, you can have a probability distribution converging on certain finite dimensional sets, but that's much weaker than requiring the distributions to converge in this uniform weak sense. And tightness is one condition that allows you to get that stronger form of convergence. The finite dimensional convergence is weaker than that. And our assumption is even weaker than the finite dimensional convergence.
So thank you very much. It seems that there's no other questions. So again,
I have a question.
Oh, there is one more.
So in proving lemma 2, you use the fact that we have a parabolic shift. Do you really need the fact that it converges to Tracy Widom distribution?
I suppose that's not essential for this specific example. In fact, we can use weaker assumptions than convergence to Tracy Widom. We really only need to assume that these one marginals are kind of uniformly tight across the integers little n. So we don't really need to assume anything about the limit. We do just need some kind of uniform control, in particular tightness, on this sequence of the top curve with the parabolic shift.
I see. Okay. Thanks.
Any other questions? If not, I encourage everyone to unmute yourself so we can give them a round of applause.